Through the years, I have posed a question to folk in the seminars, in the gathering. Which is more important, the first mile of a journey or the last mile of the journey? You've heard that question before, but let's pose it again because the answer is going to be different this morning. So let's ask the question again. Consider it before you answer. Which is more important, the first mile of a journey or the last mile of the journey? The first mile is important because that's the beginning of something. It may be a journey, it may be whatever. The first mile is important because it's an inception, it's a beginning, it's a story in the making. But if the story turns out to be an unhappy one, an unpleasant one, which is more important, the first mile or the last mile? Last mile. You want it to be over and done with. That's what the world has been praying for, waiting for thousands of years. Now, it's no surprise to those who have been in my seminars through the years or listened to me to know that early on in my ministry, early on, I led people to study the actors or characters of Scripture and put modern names on them. Who does this actor in the Bible represent? Who does Jezebel represent? We have had a real awakening with thousands of friends looking at Bible characters, actors, as though they are standing in the place of our day. We know that for thousands of years, people have been waiting and believing that the end of the world was at hand. That's what Eve thought when she was put out of the garden. Cain was born. She thought he was the promised Messiah. What a mistake. There were many who thought the flood was the end of the world. It was not. It came close, but it was not. There are things about the flood we need to discuss at another time. We go through the Bible, Old Testament, New Testament. We find characters who, in their lifetime, in their work or ministry or whatever, seem to echo. They seem to tell us ahead of time about things and people to come, events to take place. So I'm going to pose the question and then I'm going to offer my answer and I'm going to tell you we're going to share some things here that will be very controversial. Not because I want them to be, but because that's just the way people are when they hear something they haven't thought through or heard before. The first thing they want to do is challenge you. I understand, but I'm past challenging. I'm going to share some things that I've never shared before in a public forum. The books of Daniel and Revelation were told by Ellen White and by our forefathers are especially important to the last generation. So back in the 1800s, our forefathers, forebears, believed they were the last generation. But that generation has come and gone, and another one has come and gone. Well, what do we do? Because the pioneers believed that the things they had outlined as fulfillment of prophecy have all come and gone, and we're still here. It should be obvious. It should be, as Elder Hoffman would say, should be as obvious as a train wreck that our interpretations were not correct. They were not exact. The word has to be exact as far as I'm concerned, you're concerned, we're all concerned. It has to be correct. And there were prophecies of Messiah and Jesus met those prophecies Literally, we're looking at the prophecies of Daniel and Revelation, which the church, the conference church, believes have already met fulfillment, and we're just in this waiting time, testing time, whatever you want to call it. I'm not in agreement there. And I'm going to share some things that are going to be maybe troubling at first hearing, but just hear me out. I want to be able to do what the pioneers did. I want to be able to voice my opinion of what these prophecies mean. And maybe I'll be as wrong as they have been, as incorrect as others have been. But it's my freedom to be as open as they were and saying, this is what it means. I'm in the book of Daniel, chapters 7 and 8, and I'd like for you to find those two chapters. I'm going to pick up verse 9 and go forward 3 or 4 verses. I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit. Who is the eye that beheld? Well, we have to go back to the beginning of the chapter. This is a vision, a dream that was given to Daniel. Much of what happens in the book of Daniel is about the kings and other persons and personalities. But here are two visions, chapter 7 and chapter 8, that are given to Daniel. Just backing up to verse 1, 2, and 3 first, and then we'll come back to where we started in verse 9. In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and visions. He wrote the dream and told the sum of the matters. Who was Belshazzar? He was the last king of Babylon. Here we are in the middle of the book of Daniel, and we're talking about the end, and we're talking about Belshazzar. Daniel had the dream. Verse 2, Daniel spake and said, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of heaven strove upon the great sea. Winds blowing on water represents what? Prophetically. Come on, we're not strangers here.
Strife,
war, and bloodshed, and strife. Four great beasts, verse 3, came up from the sea, diverse one from another, the first like a lion with eagle's wings. I watched till his wings were plucked, and it was lifted up or made to stand on its feet as a man, and a man's heart was given to this lion. Behold, another beast, the second like a bear, it raised up itself on one side and had three ribs in its mouth, and a voice spoke to the bear and said, arise and devour much flesh. Don't know if that was a human voice or a heavenly voice, but that was the command. After this, I beheld, and lo, another like a leopard, which had on his back four wings of a fowl. The beast also had four heads, and dominion or authority was given to it. Verse 7, after this, I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast. This is the one we want to pay attention to. I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible, and strong exceedingly. It had great iron teeth. It devoured and brake in pieces and stamped the residue with the feet of it. It was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. I considered the horns, verse 8, and there came up among them another little horn, before whom three of the first were plucked up. And behold, in this horn were eyes like a man and a mouth speaking boastful things. Some of the translations say, a mouth speaking great things. Now back to verse 9. I watched, or I beheld, till the thrones were cast down. What thrones? It's not clear. But there's plenty of Bible to make it clear. We'll get there. The thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit. Who is the Ancient of Days? Is that the Holy Spirit? Is that Jesus? Is that the Father? Who's the Ancient of Days? Thank you. That becomes clear as we continue in the next two or three verses. I watched or beheld till thrones were cast down or set in place. The Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow. Hair on his head was like pure wool. His throne was like a fiery flame, his wheels as burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him, and 1,000 thousands ministered unto him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The judgment was set, and the books were opened. What books? Have to get to Revelation to find that out. The books were opened. I beheld then because of the voice of the great words which the horn spake. I watched or beheld even till the beast was slain. Is that the first, second, third, or fourth? Which beast was slain? Come on. Oh, yeah, it does.
Yeah, of course. It's the one with the little horn.
I beheld even till the beast was slain, his body destroyed and given to the burning flame. As concerning the rest of the beasts, they had their dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and a time. This is a judgment scene in heaven. The Ancient of Days we believe to be God the Father. 10,000 times 10,000, verse 10, stood before him. The judgment was set and the books were opened. We want to continue here. As concerning the rest of the beasts, verse 12, they had their dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and a time. This fourth beast is dead, is destroyed, is judged. And the first beast, the lion, the bear, and the leopard, are still alive. As concerning the rest of the beasts, they had their authority, dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and a time. Let's pause right here and get some words in. Cosmic, cosmic. What does that word do for your brain? What do you think cosmic refers to or means?
Right.
What?
Right.
Yes. Cosmic. Which came first, the creation of the cosmos or planet Earth? Was planet Earth created in 6 days, created just immediately after God spoke the cosmos into being? I don't think so. I think that the heavens were created just like it says. And over a period of time, I believe a long time, but over a period of time, the solar system that we're part of, the sun, the moon, and the various planets, the solar system that we're part of, came into being. It was a cosmic event. There were stones, there were rocks, there were bodies, and they were moving in the heavens. And in time, we had planet Earth forming around our sun. Was that a long time ago? Could be, but you and I are a cosmic event. You and I are here because of a cosmic beginning, creation. And we're still here as a cosmic event. And the end, when it finally arrives, will be a cosmic event. Great stones will fall out of the sky. Bodies, moons, asteroids, comets will be moving in our neighborhood. And we're going to approach the end of this rock, this life, this planet-bearing life. And there's going to be such devastation and ruin that all life will be erased on this rock. the people who escape this rock are the only people from this cosmic event, Earth. The only people who escape are those who are caught up to meet Jesus in the air. I'm just telling you what I believe. We're not saved down here except and until Jesus appears in the clouds. We will be saved from some terrible things, but not totally delivered until Jesus appears. When he does, we're safe because of his pronouncement, his appearing, and the angels. He says, I will give my angels charge over you, and they will save you. They will stand between you and the rocks, you and the evil men who would take your life. I want to discuss this beast that is thrown into the fiery burning flame in the planets that we're part of are still here, and there's still life, there's still action, there's still motion and still behavior. Why is it that the beast system is going to be destroyed and we're not destroyed yet? We're not saved yet or destroyed yet. What makes sense to you that it could say this beast, which has strength over all of the other beasts, finally is going to meet judgment, and he's going to be thrown into a burning lake of fire? We're not talking about the one at the end of the millennium. We're talking about in the judgment hour end. How do you account for that? How do you see that? Let me go on, and I saw in the night visions, verse 13, behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven and came to the Ancient of Days. They brought him near before him, and there was given him dominion, that's authority, rulership, and glory, and a kingdom that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. Who is this one that is receiving this Son of Man? Who is he? There was given him, verse 14, dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. I want to bring you to the controversial points here. What month is the election coming up? When is the election? What month is it? Is it November? Of this year? These are cosmic events. They are identified in the Bible, these times. They're cosmic events because all the sanctuary times and all the times are cosmic events. They are by the movement of election 2020. And when does his next presidency begin? Because I believe he's going to be reelected. It's January. That's what I'm trying to get to. January what?
2021.
So the election is in November, but he doesn't take office for his next presidency until January. Is that 2 months? So January 2020. Then it says in this discussion, like Daniel 4, you're the great tree, Daniel tells Nebuchadnezzar. You're the great tree. And you're going to do these things, and these things are going to happen to you. You're the great tree that sends food, blessing, money, whatever, to much of the world, and something happens to cut you down. He can't be cut down when he hasn't been reelected yet, and he is going to be cut down after 12 months. That's what it says. And at the end of 12 months, you're going to lose your mind. You're going to lose your authority. You're going to lose. I'll get this mapped out in a minute and it'll make some sense. I don't know that it's going to make you happy, but it'll make some sense. In Daniel chapter 4, 12 months are given in advance of him losing his mind, his king, his power, his authority, whatever. And at the end of 12 months, something's going to happen. So he would be elected in November of this year, but begin his new presidency in January of the year coming, 20. Am I saying it right? In November, there will be an election. In January, there will be a president, I believe the same president, Donald Trump, who will have 12 months. And he will, I don't want to say lose his mind, but that's what it amounts to. He's being accused today and for the last two or three years of bordering on craziness and a mental breakdown. I believe he's going to have a mental breakdown 12 months after this election, right here. He will become the new president, and in 12 months, he will cease being president. We're going to have the vice president, and that's Michael Pence. If you have an election and you're going to serve for four more years, but only one of those years takes place, how many are left?
Three.
He cannot be reelected again after that. But if he ceases to be fit for office, who would take the next 3 years? For the next 3 years would be Pence. He would be subject to one more term. He could be elected for another term. And how long would that be? 3 years plus 4 years is... Now, Vice President Pence, is he Baptist?
Yes, but I don't know.
He and his wife are very dedicated Catholic Christians. Very, very fine people. 3 years and 4 years is 7 years. And that's what we have in the formula. There's 12 months plus 7 years. And what happens at the end of the 7 years tells you in Daniel 4 and elsewhere. God appears in the heavens. What? Yes, his mind was restored to him at the end of 7 years. Yeah. The United States is going to bankrupt. We believe that. But what causes the bankruptcy? It's not a matter of having money or not. It's a matter of you got a nation here that has all the weapons. We're announcing that we're going to space. I want to tell you we've been in space and we're adding to it. We're a powerful nation militarily, and if natural disasters come and wreak havoc in this country, in North America, in the United States, you would think that the Russians would be ready to drop bombs on us and our weakness. No, Russia is going to make moves over in that part of the world and invade other territories. Those are the three countries that we've talked about before. Three ribs in the mouth of the bear. So The next one is a leopard beast with four heads and four wings. And he is moving very swiftly. I believe that's China. But China's not going to rise to the number one position, which she's going to be until the end. China does not rise to the number one position until something happens to pull the wings off the lion. Something happens to bring the United States to poverty. That's what it really amounts to. I believe, according to Daniel chapter 4, he will be reelected, but he will only have 12 months in office. If you really want to do some simple work, but important work, I was at ease in my palace, and I said, is not this great Babylon that I have built? And he loses his mind because he has exalted himself and not given God the credit for what's going on. It says, and at the end of 12 months after that, he's crazy. Okay? That's 1 year. If he is incapacitated in office, then Pence goes into office as vice president. All right, so I'm asking you to consider the possibility that we are going to have trouble politically. This is exactly where we are, is the whole world is going crazy. Nations are rioting for no apparent reason, some of them. Employees are walking out on good-paying jobs to demand more money. We've decided we're just going to walk out. Did you see that on the news? McDonald's? All their employees walked out of a major operation in Hawaii? It's time for craziness, and that's where we are. Now, what does this mean to you and me? There's a message that has to go to every kindred, tongue, nation, and people. What is that message? Is it 1844? In practical terms, we're in December of this year, and we're going to a new year in 5 days, 6 days, what is it? Doesn't matter. In November of 20, there will be an election. If Trump is reelected, you will say, is not this great prophecy that Charles has built? If Trump is reelected, and is he guaranteed reelection? No. So this is an issue. This is a what if. Now, when he becomes president, if he does become president again, what do you suppose the economy is going to do?
Get better.
Oh, I think it's going to the moon and Mars and beyond. Is there any hint in the Bible and in the writings of Ellen White that things are going to look real good and then all of a sudden? Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. I think Donald Trump is going to be reelected. And I believe that the economy of this nation and the world is going to go. But if he only has 12 months before something happens, then during the 12 months, probably right at the end, I believe cosmic events are going to take place, and I believe that there are going to be earthquakes that are going to devastate this country, this nation.
It's not going to be applied to
I believe that the United States is going to be broken. How many months are we away from?
That's wrong, really. 11 months away.
Yeah. 11 months. We've got, if there's anything in this that even approaches reality or truth, we have 11 or 12 months from now. Is that correct? And then the election would take place and he'll either be in office or somebody else will be. So in 11 or 12 months, it's really 11 months before the election takes place. There's nothing about what happens at the election that says in 12 months, he's a goner. There's nothing but Bible to create that possibility. So let's just assume, and that's what I'm doing. That's what the pioneers of Adventism did. They didn't think it was assuming, but that's what it was. I'm assuming that something is going to happen. The election is going to take place. President Trump will be reelected, and things are going to go for the moon and beyond. We're talking about financially. Economically, there will be great prosperity. Now, I want to ask you, if this were reality and true, that this timing we're talking about turns out to be true, what would you do with the next 9 months? How about paying off all your debts if possible? What if you're on poor ground like we are here? I can grow some beans and, you know, a garden, but I can't feed this whole neighborhood. I can't feed all of our families. One can't do it. Okay, so let's have three poor gardens. Let me ask you this. Should we be concerned with survival?
Somewhat, but not.
We have a part to do.
According to Ellen White, we should be very concerned about it. God has places for his people if they will but ask him. Get out of debt, pay off your debts, do all these wonderful things that we never can do because of reality. Suppose reality comes in the next 9 months. There's an infusion of wealth that comes to the ministry. What should we be doing with that money?
Witnessing books. Putting out as many books.
Should print as many books as we can and get them gone.
Right.
Right? All right, but beyond the books, and that's where I'm totally committed, because I pray every day, Lord, if you send the money, we're going to print the books.
Right.
I'm not saying, Lord, if you send the money, we're going to go buy a garden. And, you know, but I'll tell you this, I believe that very hard times are just ahead. If you're following the news, the prediction is that the next year or two globally is going to be very, very difficult to grow food for the whole world. Very difficult to grow enough, and the costs are going to soar. What would you do about it? I mean, just wait till it falls, till the rock falls out of the sky and hits you in the head? What?
We need dollars.
Do you understand how people be? You do, but you don't really think about it. When they're sending you 10 credit card applications in the mail again. Remember those days?
Yeah.
Well, it's about to happen again.
It is.
People, when the money flows easy, people go into debt. People spend. $100 to go eat a meal somewhere. Crazy. My question is, would you pray and ask God for direction for just you and your family, or this community, or the workers in the book ministry, or what? Who should we be praying for, talking about, talking to? What should be going on? This is our world because we live in this community, all right? But it's ours because God made all of this possible to this day, this place, this group of people, this whatever. And what I'm trying to do is make a prediction that when it comes true, you will say, it actually came true. Not because I want you to believe me or believe in me, but because I am convinced that things are happening, already happening. We're about to go to war with Iran. You don't keep up with it, but my phone rings every day with somebody filling me in on what's going on in the news. So yesterday, if you're interested, yesterday, I'm looking at the headlines. I'm calling you because you know what they mean. Israel has announced that it is preparing for war with Iran. The threats will ever be out there, but I don't believe we're going to go to a major war until either Israel makes a move against Iran or Iran makes a move against Israel. It's all about Jerusalem. It's all about the Holy Land. It's all about. Anyhow, I believe that Iran is going to make a move against Israel. And I believe the United States is going to come across and we're going to have a quick, fast, hot war between the United States and Iran and Great Britain and Iran. The Arab powers want a pipeline. They want to cut the U.S. out of the picture. They want a pipeline into Syria. And they can offload oil and natural gas and whatever and whatever and cut the United States out, because right now we can supply the whole world with oil and gas, and we are supplying the whole world. And they want to cut us out, and they want to run a pipeline, which they're already building, constructing. They want to run it so that Russia can take the place of the U.S. in supplying. And so they have money. Iran will have money. Everybody will get money from oil and gas. And the United States will not be able to go in and blow the place up. I believe we're going for a war before these 9 months are out. That's what I'm trying to say. We've got 9 months till the election. Maybe we'll wait till the election for the war to break out. But I think something is in the works. It seems to be. And we're going to be limited in our witness. We're going to have to witness with publications that we can print. And they can be shipped through the U.S. Postal Service and shipped to other countries and their post office or postal services. We can put out millions of books. And if we can do that within how many months before? 9 months and then 12 months. How many months is that? In 21 months, you'll have to pay off all your debts, get your garden ready to grow, and help us get millions of books into the postal service of many countries. What would have to happen between now and then, in the 21 months, what would have to happen between now and then that would cause you to say, hey, there may be something to this? See, I'm not looking for fame and glory. That's gone. I'm looking for understanding And when the election and the things, the powers, the governmental powers that are in place are talking in terms of this many months and this many this and this and this, and it begins to make sense with the visions, prophecies, then somebody needs to be. If you knew that something is on the way, there will be a mighty earthquake, but you don't know the day. It has to wait and happen. If you knew there was predicted, and it is predicted by Jesus, by Daniel, by John, it is predicted that there is a crisis coming, and it's going to be global. The four winds of heaven strove upon the great sea. If you knew something was coming, would you ask God for specifics? Here's my question. If you're sensing, if the world is sensing, and it is, that something is about to happen or is already begun to happen, that unrest, famine, pestilence, earthquake, war and bloodshed, if you were convinced that something like this is in the offing, what would be your first step? You would pray, and what would you ask for? Lord, show me, show us what to, come on, what to do. If we're supposed to do this now, make it plain. And what are we supposed to do? Make it plain, please, so that we're not left bewildered, wondering, wandering. And that's where we are. That's where the world is. That's where the nations are. We know that there's trouble brewing, but that's all we know. We don't know time. Who is master of time? God. And if he chooses, he can make known the times. That's what he says. That's what the Bible says. That's what Jesus says. That's what the prophets say. In Daniel chapter 12, but the wise will understand. And what does the word wise, when you look it up in there, mean? They are observers of the times. That's what the wise mean. They are observers of the times. So, would you wait 9 or 10 months to see if something happens and then pray and ask for direction? Does that make sense? No, it doesn't make sense to me. Who was it that prayed, that said, you want me to do this and you want us to do that, but you're going to have to make the fleece wet when all the rest of the ground is dry? Who was it?
Gideon.
Do you think it's presumption to ask God to give us make some demonstration that if this is the time and this is us and this is what we're supposed to do, show us what to do? And my question is, do you believe God will actually show people what to do? I believe that's what he did in the formation of this book work, this ministry. And it was very precise. He told me, this is what I want you to do. I'll make a way financially. So one more experience. One of the things that the Lord made clear in my thinking, my mind, was that I want you to start a work for the prisons and jails. I want you to print the books, and I want them to go into the prisons and jails all across the country. So we're ready to begin this ministry. Where do we begin? So we called a little prayer meeting in the living room in my house, and Lord, you said count the cost. We've been counting the cost, and it looks like we need $10,000 to start this this book work for the prisons and jails. We need $10,000. That's a lot of money when you don't have any. Still a lot of money. And we prayed that if you want us to do this, then you send us the $10,000 and we'll know where to start the prison ministry. Got up off our knees in the living room right over there, walked out to the mailbox. I did. Walked out to the mailbox. 1 6¾-inch envelope. Charles Wheeling, Jemison, Alabama. That's all the address. Came from California. Charles Wheeling, Jemison, Alabama. All the way from California. I didn't know the name. Didn't recognize the name. I opened the envelope, and inside was a check for $10,000. Now, that's about 3 minutes from the house to the mailbox. We prayed, Lord, if this is what you want us to do, start the prison ministry, send the $10,000. Get to the mailbox. Brother Wheeling, I was impressed to send you this money. That's all it said. Do you send $10,000 to folks just on a whim? No. Who impressed that young man, whoever he was, and whoever he is, who impressed him to send $10,000? And who impressed him to send it several days before, and it arrived there 3 minutes after we got off our knees? Is that a miracle? Would you classify that as a miracle? How many of those would you have to see before you knew that God was in it? Only one? I believe we're about to multiply these miracles that brought this book work into being. We're about to multiply these, and we're about to print millions and millions and millions of books. We cannot afford to let preparation go on the back burner. That's what I'm trying to say. 32 years ago when we formed this ministry, 35, 36, 37, 39 years ago when we formed this ministry, I didn't have the shakes. Ivan and June weren't old senior citizens. So what do we need to do? The Lord is going to have to direct and show and make the way. I've seen him do it. I know he can do it. I know he will do it. But things are going to start happening, and when they do, I'm going to be calling on you and asking you to become part of it. If that happens, if God makes a way, he'll make a way for you, for us, for this work. He does that, and when he does, in Ellen White's terms, he's going to take the reins into his own hands. We're talking about horse and buggy days. He's going to take the reins into his own hands, and he's going to make a speedy work. What does that mean? And what if you didn't plan on a speedy work? Does God pass people by who don't take up the work when the time comes? So who was it that prayed for the fleece to be dry?
Gideon.
Dry and wet. Wet and dry. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. We're 10 days away from a new year. How many days are we?
Just the first of January.
So we're 4 or 5 days away. Okay. This is the fleece I'm going to put out in front of the Lord and in front of you. Lord, there needs to be some indication, some clear, plain indication in 3 or 4 days, 5 days, whatever it is, till the end of this year and the beginning of the next. Make it clear, make it plain that the means are coming and the work can go forward, so we can make decisions very quickly. And then if that happens, will I be happy? Yes. Will I be nervous and anxious? Yes. But if you see something happen economically, financially, in the next 4 or 5 days, you'll be a witness. Okay?
White House returns.
I need some clear direction, and that's what I'm asking for. Clear direction. I need to know. I want to know. I'm asking for your direction. You've done this for us in the past. You've kept your word. Let's do it again. Let you do it again and finish the work. If something happens in the next 4 or 5 days, whatever, here, I may call you in the middle of the night and say, ha, 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 ha. Then you may call me, but not in the middle of the night, and say, ha, 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 ha. Father in heaven, you are the mighty one. You are the ruler of all the cosmos, all of heaven. You are good. You are wise. You are mighty. The things that we lack are the things that you have, and the things that you are, and the things that you promised to share with us. Jesus said, whatever you need, ask your Father in my name. And so I'm asking in the name of Jesus that you continue to bless this little community, this little ministry, and help us to see things so great that we will rejoice and sing and praise God. Thank you for a meal we're going to share here. Thank you for your goodness. In Jesus' name, amen.